the M6 turnoff to Bedworth and Nuneaton, a path to George Eliot country. Her childhood home, now a comfortable hotel, serving chips and accepting credit cards. The descendants of her sturdy yeomanry today have the convenience of purpose-built housing and, better still, a hospital bearing her illustrious name. George Eliot Hospital, Nuneaton. Connie Downs remembers.
I remember receiving an urgent telephone call saying that my uncle, George Kirk, had been taken into hospital and that he was desperately ill. So I came with my mother to the hospital. And as we walked into the ward, I saw him lying there, and he looked so pale and ill. And my mother shouted into his ear, "George, Connie's come to see you." But he didn't move, he just lay there. And then after a few minutes, he slowly turned his head. And he looked at me very fiercely, as much as to say, "Well, you've left it a bit late." But he didn't do anything. He didn't say anything. And then, very slowly, he turned his head away and closed his eyes. And my mother said, "He won't speak." And a few days later, I heard that he died. I can see him there now with his head bent over the bench, and he would be carving away, and his hair was standing on end, and he had on his old grey trousers flopping around his ankles and the braces over his shoulders. He also had a habit of taking snuff, so quite often the snuff was all over the front of his shirt. He was something of an encumbrance, being disabled. He tended to be an object of derision. So I never recall him being on any wedding photographs, any of the important happenings in people's lives, in a family. My grandmother and also my grandfather tended to tell him to shut up if ever he started to talk about anything. They had a son who had no intellect, and he tended to be not only pushed in the background but left to his own devices.
Nuneaton Gallery, an unimpressed attendant with an exhibition of primitive paintings. Curious paintings and carvings. Haunted, they seemed, and beckoned to a world of experiences we had no knowledge of. Who painted them, and what did they mean to the artist? And so began a search for a man called George Kirk. 2 years before, Penny Johnson and Pam Evans discovered the dust-covered pictures in a second-hand shop in Nuneaton. Unwanted, it seemed. Waiting. From obscurity, though Nuneaton has its links with the famous, Larry Grayson is a son of the town, the paintings moved to Bond Street and graced the walls of the Portal Gallery, renowned experts of naive and primitive art. So, George James Kirk, primitive, 1901 to 1974, is described in a glossy brochure. Nowadays, it is a rare occurrence for a genuine primitive artist of such considerable vision to surface. He was such a man. Some pictures are in collections in Europe, one in a museum in New York. But the glitter of Bond Street is far indeed from 23 John Street, Nuneaton, where George lived most of his life. His neighbour, Mr. Jack Dickens, wanted nothing to do with our rude interest in a man long dead and left us. Mrs. French understandably won't appear. Her door is firmly shut. She is nearly 80, and the last time strangers entered, £7 went missing, so we were told. She remembers George. Behind another of the facades, we met Mrs. Hobbins.
He always kept himself to himself. And sometimes he wouldn't speak to you, you see. The last time I spoke to him was when I'd come out, I went out the door, and he laid on the wall outside here. And I went out to him and I says, "What's the matter, Mr. Kirk?" He said, "I feel bad." I said, "Can I take your bag up?" He says, "No, thank you." He says, "I'm doing it myself." And that's the last I spoke of him. The month as the war broke out, I came into the street. Because it's a street where they don't neighbour. They all keep themselves to themselves, like. So I've never seen them paintings. I was surprised to hear about him, I might tell you. Very, very surprised. Because I didn't think he was a man like it.
Mrs. Emery remembers George, for there was a time, years ago, when she helped him clean about the house.
I used to see him stand at the bottom of the entry with the dog. He was happy enough on his own. He seemed contented in his way, because it can't be helped, really, can it? It's just one of them things. Well, he's just sitting, you know, just mumbling to himself, and he used to do a bit of woodwork and then pictures and painting, and that was his way of living. Well, I used to go round every morning and make the house clean for him from when he come home from work. He worked at the pit. He used to go regularly, never used to have time off at all. I got on with him all right, because he wouldn't do anybody any harm or anything. He just seemed a man that used in his own world, as you might say.
Connie Albrighton's image of George seemed clearer.
Sometimes he'd go weeks and not speak to anyone, which must have been really awful for him not to make any conversation. All he had was his dog, really, to talk to. In his younger years, he was quite a handsome fella. He was never very interested in women. When his mother died, he sort of went a bit, you know, he was neglected sort of thing. He always went about with Wellingtons on, an old navy coat, short coat, and he wore a cap because he was bald as he got older. And he was very deaf, so he didn't hear what she said properly. And we always called him Happy. Whenever we spoke to him, he wouldn't hear what we were saying, but he'd laugh at you, though he hadn't heard what you'd said. He'd laugh, you know. So from then, we always give him a nickname, Happy Kirk.
But he was quite harmless, and I tried to get converse with him on several occasions, but he would say the odd word and no more. You couldn't get a conversation with him.
Mind you, he was a character in himself, was George. He, odd ways he'd got. And although a lot of people used to think that he was, what can I put it? Not quite the ticket. They used to think he was mental.
Yes.
We thought that he was laughing at us, sort of thing. Whether he thought we were the funny ones and he was all right, I don't know. Probably he did.
Thank you.
his paintings were very primitive, childlike, I would say. You would expect a five-year-old to do paintings such as they were, very primitive.
They're out-of-this-world paintings. The only way I could describe it. The thing was, you looked at them and you said, well, what an earthly use is that? So we took them out and burned them. But you just couldn't put any value on the paintings.
I think the portrait of the lady that's in his pictures must have been an early portrait of his mother. Later on in life, he did have an acquaintance with a lady that he met in a pub in town. And she used to come home with him, but never stayed the night, you know. She didn't stay all night with him. No.
I liked the man. Always did. As I say, he was quite homeless and he would never do anyone any harm.
I think he was quite happy with his paintings and keeping himself occupied in his own home, but he wouldn't let anybody else be friendly with him. A loner, really. Very much a loner.
Mrs. Sidwell, Connie Albrighton's mother, was his landlady.
That illness that he had left him quite a queer fella, you know. He used to make awful funny noises. And the children in the street used to be frightened to death at him with the noises he used to make and the way he used to pull faces and do and shirk his body about. When he came from work, he'd sit at the corner of the top of the garden, not top of the house, by the wall, and he'd have his legs sprawled out like this. And he wouldn't pull them up for nobody to go by. You'd have to step over him or go round and get into the gutter. But if you went round and went in the gutter, he'd laugh. He'd go, ho, 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 you know, laugh at you. But if you stepped over, he'd pull a funny face at you, if you stepped over him. So I only stepped over him once, and I thought to myself, well, you are a fool, you might have pulled his legs up and legged you over. But I don't think he would. I don't think he'd harm anybody. And he was straightforward enough. He was honest. He didn't, I don't think he owed anybody a penny. Not a penny. He didn't owe me none anyway. Your neighbours today, they don't seem as if they want to know you. They just say, I do, pass on. I mean, the young ones, they've got no time for royalty. I honestly hope that Prince Charles and Princess or Lady Diana, whatever her name is, I hope they'll be very, very happy. And I hope he'll make a good king. And I hope she'll make a good queen. And if she's anything like our own queen,
he must have had something on his mind, mustn't he? He must have had imagination to have done those pictures, mustn't he? There must have been something there, mustn't there? He just painted things as he saw them, very flat. I don't think myself there was a lot of life in them. There wasn't no difference in the variety of them, was there? I don't think there was, anyway. He carved a wooden horse out once. There must have been something he thought about. Horses, you see, those sort of things.
He was a great man because he not only fulfilled himself through his painting and through his carving, through his gardening, through his cycling, and everything else creative that he was interested in, but because he overcame all the difficulties that had been in his path, the fact that he was practically totally deaf, and right from a very early age when he had meningitis and later diphtheria, that people disregarded that illness, because in those days there was no social service to look after people, and consequently he overcame what to most people would have been a complete tragedy that would have ruined their life. But he had some tremendous inner resource that helped him to become a great man. He fulfilled himself in that way through his paintings. I've learned that the best thing in life is hope, and I'm sure that George Kirk had hope, despite the fact that he was rejected by so many people including neighbours in the street, by his family, by his nephews, and myself.
To everlasting life.
Amen.
The blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was shed for you, preserve your body and soul to everlasting life.
Amen. He once sent some of his paintings to Sotheby's, and again, this shows that he was certainly not lacking in intelligence to know that Sotheby's was the place to send them to. I think he must have felt that his work was worthwhile, and when they were rejected by Sotheby's, he started to exhibit them in his own front window. And the strange thing about it, when we cleared the house after he died, we did ask neighbours if they would like any of his paintings, and not one of them wanted one.
I've only seen one painting, and that was one of his dog in front of the house, and that was the first painting he ever done. But the others, I never used to take much notice of them. I just thought it was a novelty to him, you know.
Kit Brown once lived in John Street. She returned to George's old home, modernised now with all the comforts of our affluent society.
That's a big change. Whoever thought this lot up? Beautiful. Well, I think George would like this picture. He might have copied that one, because he was clever, really. It's a lovely place. I don't think George would like it, though. Be too posh for him. When I was here, we used to have a big black fire grate here. We used to have black leaded. And also in the kitchen, there was a black leaded grate as well. Well, this is nice. Oh, wouldn't his mother have been pleased to have seen this? He wouldn't have kept it like it, though. He used to stand here and do his painting on an old table. There used to be a fireplace up here, up this end, because he used to keep his corn and that here for his fowl. Because it used to harbour mice, and the mice used to run from this fireplace to the fireplace into my place. You know, right through. Then he used to have an old table here, and he used to stick his painting up here to paint.
He'd done these paintings, but we just naturally thought as he were doing them just for an hobby, you know. Never really took interest in them properly. The more hobbies he had when his mum were alive was setting the garden and looking after the fowl when his mum were alive. He used to play a melodeon. He used to sit in the yard and play his melodeon, because he couldn't tell what he was playing. He used to make a noise on it, you know. He was a chap as nobody would understand. I could understand him. Of course, his mother learnt me a lot of ways when she was alive with him, you see. That's how I got to know him properly. But his mum slept down in the front room because she couldn't get upstairs, because she suffered the gout a lot. I know, I hadn't been well that morning when she died. So when he rode, we set to and done what we could. We laid her out, me and Mrs. Dickens laid her out, and then George come in and we phoned the doctor. And then George come in and we told him, and he come and sat inside the bed. He never said a word. He just sat there staring, you know. He couldn't believe his own eyes. But I overrun my tail. When we was getting her back into bed, she looked at me and she says to me, she says, "Look after our George." She had a nice funeral. Me and Mrs. Dickens come and done the catering. I know it was a cold day. I know we found the whiskey bottle and we had a drink of whiskey because it was cold. Oh, but she had a lovely funeral. She had a lot of flowers. Of course, his dad died sudden as well, you know. He died at the pictures in the Scala Theatre, what used to be up Abbey Street. He dropped down dead.
To the pictures an awful lot, and he used to see the pictures of Tarzan. Whether he used to exercise himself to make himself look that bit better, I don't know.
He used to strip to the waist, then he used to stand at the window and he'd beat his chest and he'd go, "Tarzan! Tarzan of the apes! I'm Tarzan!" And that's how he'd go. We used to be down the garden watching him. killing ourselves and laughing, Mrs. Dickens and I, laughing at him.
Well, he had one girl, I'm thinking her name was Olive, I'm sure it was, but me and Rainey got shut of her. We told her to, you know, to buzz off. Well, we think she was after his money, you know, because I think she come from, used to go in the pub in the Queens in the town, and that was a bit of a you know, a pick-up place. Used to be, whether it is today, I don't know. He had a girl years ago, that before I come to live here, and I was going to get married, so his mum told me, and she jilted him. So I don't think he really bothered with anybody till he picked up this other girl in the pub.
Yes, because she wasn't a good woman. She was only there to get his money because she knew he'd got a little bit of money. She was a woman that went with any old Tom, Dick and Harry. No, I don't think it was a good thing at all. George, in his way, he was happy enough. We used to call him happy. He was happy enough in his own tin pot way, George was.
George began work shortly after the First World War in a land fit for heroes.
The present strike is of a nature quite unlike the many others which have preceded it. There is no moral justification for a general strike.
26 strike, we'd got no food, hadn't even got a bit of bread and lager for a Sunday dinner. And they used to issue as jugs of soup out, different families.
They fear that we are living beyond our means and may continue to do so. And that we are no longer exporting enough.
I remember the years of 30 when we are today, your money's no good. I mean, the day down your mates, everybody. You've been and bought all your groceries and that. You ain't got much more to spare.
His Majesty the King passed peacefully away.
You had to rough it, didn't we? You had to get by the best roads you can. You could. I had four kids to keep on.
A few hours ago, I discharged my last duty as king and
emperor. You went and that to find out of that and clothe the kids on. I mean, what the only one.
No such undertaking has been received. And that consequently, this country is at war. With
they dropped a basket of sentry bombs along here, and that house over there that they got bombed when the miner come from work, the eggs were all cooked in the basin, they're all hard boiled.
British and American have made the atomic bomb at last. The first one was dropped on a Japanese city this morning.
After the war, yes. We all thought it was going to be a lot better. We all clung together up this street.
By being a single weekly contribution through one insurance stamp, everyone will be able to get all the benefits.
Dreams? Well, I don't know, I'm sure. I think my dreams all faded away.
His working life ended after about 50 years in Newdigate Colliery, working as a tub thumper, a carpenter of great skill. Every working day, he cycled to and from the colliery. So much had happened after all those years of cycling.
George was alive, there would be all miners in the street, all but two men. They were all miners in the street, all but about two men.
Albert Yardley and John Clark both worked alongside George. They too seemed to have a very definite image of him spanning all those years.
The very first time I followed George, we met. I started in 51, but we'll say 2 years after, and say we'll go to 53 or 4. I was biking behind him from work. I lived at Bedworth at the time. And I was a foreigner to work, and he always used to brought us as I come through Bedford on his bicycle, country yard, always. And he used to come along and he'd bike so far along the road. This particular day, I always recall it, of course I saw him times and times after, but I'm on about the very first time. And he'd rise up off his saddle and turn round and he'd go, ha 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 ha! And he'd go back again to his bike, and off again he'd go, and he'd go another 20, 30 yards, and he'd do the same thing again, and off again he'd go again, till he got to the pit. He might turn around two or three times in that short distance, but he'd move off his saddle, and just turn round, and make this row, because he fricked me to damn death. I'll never forget it when I got to work. I remember telling the chaps about it. I thought, Christ me, I've never seen nothing like it. But that's the thing is, I heard a lot of times after, but that was the very first time. Yes, I think George, myself, speaking for myself, was a perfectly happy man. And anybody who's turned around and says to me as he wasn't, you know, under the weather, I can't agree with that at all, for the jobs he used to do.
Because George's father was a staff man, he was over the locomotive department. His dad was on the staff. So I worked with his dad when I first started here. Then his dad told me lots of things about him, you know, how he used to go up for the Saturday afternoon when he actually come from work on the Saturday and they wouldn't see him again till Sunday evening. And he used to bark to Skegness and places like that.
He was a very physically fit man, wasn't he? Without a doubt, he was physically fit.
Nobody took the mickey out of George, they were frightened too, he was too strong.
No, George was a very good man for his job and for his work. That's as far as I can say. And as regards doing a job, when he done a job, he done it properly. I found him to me, clever. To me, I thought he was a clever man, because the jobs he used to do, we've heard people say, is not just what he should be, but the jobs he used to do, his brain had got to be working to do the jobs he used to have to do. His greatest pleasure, I should say his work, I don't know about his private life, but I should say he's coming to work because he never missed a day, did he, work?
He must have
loved it, mustn't he? And his job, they didn't put him on a job and he'd go away and leave it. He'd stop on it all the while, not like we do today.
For work, and rightly so, fills the lives of men and women. And after a lifetime of toil, a period of rest, unfettered by the problems of running a home. Sheltered accommodation under kindly supervision. There we met Alf Richardson. He worked with George long ago.
I was there 48 years. 1918 I started. I used to repair the joeys and tubs. The joeys had sent the timber down the pit. He was there longer than me. He still kept on with the carpenter's shop. A few of them used to have a bit of fun with him, and he used to take it all right on the right side. He's nervous. He's on the nervous side. Until he used to think somebody was on his shoulder, he used to shake it, shake him off at different times, and used to go like that. He thinks somebody on the back of his shoulder. They used to laugh out and shake this off, and he'd get over it again then. When he had these attacks, people thought he was that funny and then never piled up with it much. It was this nervous complaint he'd got. And he took up the painting.
32. On its own. Number 8. 1 and 8. 18. 2 and 7. 27. 3 and 8. 38. 1 and 7, 17. 5 and 6, 56. All the sevens, 77. 1 and 9, 19. 6 and 4, 64. 2 and 6, 26. On its own, number 5.
Yes.
Curious indeed is the case of George Kirk. Not for George the fraternal home with Bingo. Hardly the creative pleasure of modernising his home. He never owned it. Nor yet the grand spirituality of the cathedral. Perhaps they were too busy building it. He couldn't indulge in the national fervour of royal romances and other pageants. He was deaf and didn't have a television. Ballroom dancing to the waltz Catherine required a good woman, and women who went with any old Tom, Dick and Harry weren't fit partners. So after retirement, he drifted into his own world, reclusive and shunned, a shambling figure to his neighbour Shirley Haywood.
I did try to avoid him when we first moved here. We used to use the front door instead of the back, but after I had the children and I got the pram, I'd got to come round the back at some time or other. But the children were always frightened of him. It was just the impression that he gave. I mean, to speak to someone and not have them reply and just to stand and stare at you. I think he thought that everyone else was mad and he was all right. The house next door had never been very clean all the while we lived here. To walk round the back, he'd got the smells from the drain and the toilet, and his kitchen that he used to sleep in, eat in. He used to drag an old couch into there every night. About 12 months before he died, we started to get the smells seeping through the walls into our house. At first, I thought it was a gas leak, so I had the gas board up, and they tested everywhere and said it was all clear. So eventually, thinking of our health and the children's health, I went down to the health department to see if they could do anything. And they came up and saw the state that the house was in and George was in. And they got in touch with social services, who then got in touch with his doctor. And the doctor got him into hospital.
Like, as he got on a bit, the smell was terrible. He couldn't help it, and it was cancer, you see, the bowels. And he didn't live long.
Indeed, a sea of unconscious urges, dreams and hopes, for dreams are the stuff that we fashion our world of. That's the way we shape our feelings into physical reality. George did it through his pictures. But Newdigate Colliery is closing. The coal that was delved, the comradeship, the jobs and the jibes will fade as memories of George have. The men here are fortunate. Most have found work in other collieries.
This area at the moment, the job situation's terrible. With all the car factories closing down in Coventry, all the engineering factories are closing down, and the job situation is really poor. And when you've got children that want to get on, want to do something, and then you see the teenagers of today just standing in the dole queues, just hoping that something's going to turn up for them. And will your children be like that?
Unemployment, it gets worse every day, doesn't it? Goodness knows, I don't know. The shoeing's gone. Biggest part of the hosiery's gone. Well, I mean, why are they letting all this foreign stuff come in instead of employing our own people?
They don't give them work. There's no future for them, is there? No future at all.
This kid is leaving school now. There's nothing for them to do. And nowhere to go.
They've got no money, have they? I mean, to go anywhere. I mean, if they go on the dole, they only get the dole for 12 months. Then they have to go on Social Security, don't they? Well, what's futures for them? No future at all. I mean, when kids are coming round to about 16, you say to them, well, what are you going to do? They say, what is that? No hope at all, unless something drastically changed.
George Kirk did have hope, but he didn't really enjoy the rewards of a Britain that had never had it so good. His neighbours didn't understand his afflictions, so locked into his own powerful inner life, he fulfilled himself through painting. But in John Street, and all streets where men and women are taught the necessary business of producing and consuming, that curious balance of economic survival we cling to so stubbornly, manufacturing our dreams in plastic and chrome, people are without jobs now, without the wherewithal to buy that elusive inner life. And so they march. But where really are we marching to?
George in his way, he was happy enough, we used to call him happy, he was happy enough in his own tin pot way, George was. Thank you.